Hello, everybody. Hello. And welcome to the Color Strategies Symposium. This is an eighth event that Saturated Space has organized. I have been running together with Adam Furman Saturated Space for the last few years. And here is Adam to introduce the and say a little something about Saturated Space also, hopefully.
Hello, welcome. Thank you for turning up. It's always nice. It's been, this is actually the fifth anniversary now of Saturated Space. So nice to have you for the eighth event on the fifth year. We've had many of these and they've all been rather fantastic. From Cambridge to Venice Biennale to lots of those hosted at the wonderful AA. Thank you, Manija, for organizing all of this. You've been brilliant behind the scenes, making sure it can happen and getting our guests here. Saturated Space, as well as having events like this, which are spearheaded by Antoni, we also have an online presence, which is to do with research and publications. So please do visit our website, which is saturatedspace.org. And we have a roll call of many dozens of research papers and sort of creative texts by many different practitioners across the world, which that we don't have a regular publishing schedule, but we do sort of intermittently produce these long and very interesting texts. So if you're sort of, you're excited by what you see today, you're geeky about color and architecture, you love Fiona's and colleagues' exhibition, please do visit and have a look at all of our texts, and new ones will be coming up online shortly. We also have some of the videos from the previous events. So we're going to have five great speakers today. We're going to begin with Fiona McLachlan, whose exhibition together with her colleagues is opening upstairs, and I hope you're all going to enjoy later and spend some time getting to know, which is in conjunction with her second book, which follows on from the architectural color in the professional palette. So this is a sort of long-running research area for Fiona, who is a well-known academic at the Edinburgh School of Architecture, which she ran for many years, and is also a practicing architect. Followed by Nicholas Fox Weber, who's joining us from the United States. Thank you for coming. Who's sort of writes books and essays prolifically, it may say, and runs the Joseph and Annie Albers Foundation, as well as spearheading a non-profit organization which was founded to assist with medical care and education in Senegal. So very, very sort of broad range of interests, but a real focus on color and Albers. We then have Eric Parry, who's was a preeminent architect in Britain. I'm sure you all know his sort of built works and also the upcoming projects which he has all over this city. I'm very excited to hear what he has to say, because there's been a really interesting sort of investigation into polychromy and craft in recent projects that he's been doing, which is unique amongst his contemporaries. Then the wonderful Antoni Malinowski, who this is all down to, will be talking to you about his practice and color, or sort of spatial color from an artistic perspective in architecture. Lastly, not least, we have Joanna Gravunda, who's a designer and architect based in Milan, and also in San Francisco, from where she's flown, and with incredible grace is fighting through what I imagine must be some level of tiredness to present to you today. She does work that's pretty much at every scale: architectural scale, public installations, interiors, art pieces, furniture, fittings, custom commissions, as well as having been a partner at Sozas Associati for many years. So it's a really exciting lineup, and I'm going to hand over to Fiona. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Adam, and particularly to Antoni Malinowski for bringing us all here this afternoon. I'm just looking forward to hearing all the speakers, actually. I think it's going to be a really lovely afternoon. I first met Antoni only about a year and a half ago, I think it was, and the reason I came down here to the Architectural Association was because I'd been writing a paper for the Architectural Theory Review in which I wrote that architecture schools are no longer teaching colour. And the editor scored it out and said, you can't say that because you have no evidence. And so I had to go about getting some evidence. And thankfully, I got a small grant which allowed me to do a benchmarking tour of the UK. And the only school I found with teaching of colour formally on the curriculum is the Architectural Association and Antoni's first year course. Although there had been other places, it's terribly vulnerable because people retire and so on. So from that, this collaboration, I suppose, and has all found from that point. My own research, as Adam says, sort of sits between practice and theory and between research and teaching. And for the last 8 years, this has focused specifically on colour. I suppose why colours is one of the most obvious reasons. We're aware that there are practicing architects out there who use colour in a very intelligent and knowing manner, and perhaps best known of the moment is Saarbrücken, and this is their Brandhurst Museum in Munich. Now, I suppose what I felt with colour is that there are just two things to begin with. First of all, colour doesn't make poor architecture good. It just doesn't. And yet there's an awful lot of people just using colour on buildings and using it in quite a naive or arbitrary manner. And I wondered if this was partly because we've stopped teaching colour. So those are kind of two drivers behind my own investigations into the work. Now here I think this project is particularly interesting because it reminds us of a number of things that we sometimes misunderstand about colour. For example, when you go up close to the building, you see all these different rods of different colours, but then when you stand back, it all gradually merges into a sort of uniform beigey colour. And it reminds us that colour is light. So all we're seeing is the reflected colour that's not absorbed by the material coming into our eyes. And it also reminds us that, therefore, colour is experienced as both a sensory and an intellectual phenomenon. So we're experiencing it through our senses, but we're also interpreting it in a cognitive manner. The exhibition upstairs and the book focuses on the idea of strategic colour. So how can we use colour in a way that's less arbitrary, that's inherent in the way we design and actually how we think about colour? Not surprisingly, because I think we are quite nervous about use of colour as architects, many architects, and perhaps some of the best examples of use of colour, are with teams where an artist will collaborate with an architect or a consultant, a colour consultant, such as Antoni's work with Howarth Tompkins, which I'm sure we're going to hear about in a minute. And indeed, you've worked with Eric Parry as well, haven't you? Yeah. So these collaborations are usually very fruitful, but I think it's also partly because of this lack of confidence amongst architects. So, as Adam mentioned, I'm a practicing architect, and my interest in colour comes from practice. So my investigation, trying to shift that into a theoretical position, started with practice, and it started by documenting the colours that our practice had used over about 30 years in practice. And it was a very intuitive way of approaching research. I simply wanted to make a painting, which is a triptych painting, which documented all of these colours. It is then true that if you stand back from it and read it, you read lots and lots of different things into it. So it's a way of understanding what was actually going on. For instance, it's chronologically ordered from the left-hand side to the right-hand side, so you can actually see the influence of time for instance, in the 1980s colours up on the top left, and then going through to 2008 or so on the right-hand side. But also there's the influence of typology. As in the central section, we were doing a lot of social housing in the practice, and you just couldn't use the more intense colours because you didn't have any connection with the end user. So it's a much more subdued palette. I think you also see interaction. You can actually understand how specific colours relate to each other, how boundaries appear, either diffused or very sharp in that way. So although it's an abstracted device, it made me convinced that although we had been using colour in a very intuitive way, it wasn't without principles. So there were tacit underlying principles in the work. As Adam mentioned, this led then to a first book, which is Architectural Colour in the Professional Palette. And this came from practice. So again, as a practitioner, researcher, my instinct was to go and talk to people, and the book has 8 chapters really based on conversations with people like Caruso St. John, O'Donnell and Toomey, Guillaume Gear in Switzerland, and so on. And I was conscious at the time, I was kind of driven by this quotation, that actually what architects need is some form of logic to organise our thoughts about colour. And that was really where that that book was really trying to address that consideration. But it still left with a question, which was, well, what does the colour actually do? And by complete chance, I really enjoy chance occasions. I was at a conference and I came across these people who are sitting in the front row here, so you can wave at this point. Stephanie Wettstein, Lino Sibiliano, Anna-Marie Nesser, who unfortunately couldn't make it here today, she's now in Wuppertal, and Marcella Wenger de Gabriel. And their work just struck an immediate chord with me. They're based at the Haus der Farbe in Zurich, which is, I think, a pretty unique institution for the teaching and research of colour, predominantly in the built environment. And it's a very craft-based approach. It's a very material and hands-on physical approach. And I just enjoyed that relationship. And immediately we felt we could work together, and the result is now 3 or 4 years later, we have very much enjoyed our collaboration. What we decided to do was focus on this idea of strategic colour. And so we selected 6 architectural practices, 2 in Zurich, 2 in Berlin, and 2 in Edinburgh, which represented a range, a period from about 1920 through to the present day. But it was important to say that at the outset, we didn't know exactly what we were going to find. We knew that there was obviously strategic use of colour there, but we didn't know specifically what we were going to reveal with the work. The first task was to learn a method, and I was delighted to get a small grant to take 3 students from Edinburgh University, 2 architecture students and a fine arts student, to Zurich, and we spent an enjoyable week learning how to observe colour in the field. So you're actually looking at colour in buildings, trying to match what you're seeing, and then mixing it, replicating it with acrylic paint. And that's the basis of the exhibition upstairs. So everything is observed by eye, hand mixed, and it can take a very long time just to get one colour. You have to kind of dry it in between each one. Establishing that methodology was really important because we had to then work in 3 different places, in Zurich, in Berlin, and in Edinburgh. And we wanted to make sure that the work was consistent across all of those places. So I really enjoy working with Swiss people. I have to say this now, because even the brush, direction of the brush had to be exactly the same on every sheet, and then when we cut them, they all have to be exactly the same order. So I hope you notice that when you go upstairs. So it is a repeatable methodology. That's the, that was the first thing to say. So just a little bit more about the process that we're undergoing. This is a way of measuring colour as an experience. So rather than a scientific measure, what we're trying to represent is actually how we experience it in an architectural setting, which is not to say that you're going to go up and measure it with some sort of meter. What we're doing is making a judgment, and I was quite skeptical at first because I thought, do we all see it the same, and so on. But I was really reassured that if you take about four people to a site, we can actually agree, even with something complex like brick, what we're actually seeing, what we're experiencing, matching that to a particular colour and then replicating it. And it quickly became apparent that, for instance, on the right-hand side, Riachan Hall, Scottish architects, very kindly gave me a box of all their materials for projects. But actually that's not, you can't just measure one brick, you have to experience it in practice. So it's this phenomenological experience, really, of colour. And we feel that's an original research in that way. So here are my three students in Edinburgh mixing after the observations on site. So what we're doing is mixing the colours first of all, and then standing back and thinking about what we've done, what we've made. These are the very, very subtle colours from Riachan Hall's Forth Valley College, which is a project in central Scotland, which just has these very soft tonal shifts. What I think is also really important about this methodology is the time to think. So it's a very, it is a slow process, it's taken us a number of years, but as you're actually trying to mix the paint, you're always thinking, how am I, what's the colour, what is the colour, how do I adjust it, how can I match this? And you learn about how the relationships between the colours. It's also very therapeutic, I must admit, as a period after two periods of head of school. I can really recommend rolling paint on a sheet of paper. It's a very nice effect. But I was also struck by this quotation by Richard Sennett, who says, making is thinking. And I think it's this time factor that actually allows you to think at the same time as you're making. So it's somehow got this tangible feeling to it. So once we have documented all of the colours, and these are smaller swatches, and upstairs you can see all 350-odd colours that we made, only then did we really start to think about what we were seeing and trying to analyse it. And it's at this time that I think the interdisciplinary nature of the team was important. I'm an architect. We have architectural art historians, two art historians, and a colour designer. And it's the different experiences that these people bring to the discussion and so forth that I think generates a very interesting inductive process. I found it quite useful to think of the research in relation to this diagram, which is by Graham Sullivan, when he's talking about art practice research. So it's about the spinning, if you like, of new knowledge, of actually creation of new knowledge through an expansive process. So in our case, he talks about rope or threads coming in from the left-hand side. In our case, that's the buildings, that's the data, the actual original data. And then it's unwound, so we unraveled it by making all of these documentations of the colour. And then you start to thread it back together, to braid it, to actually bring it together until gradually new knowledge comes on the right-hand side. And I genuinely believe that's the kind of process that happened with us with this interdisciplinary team. And the result is, I can wave it at this point, beautiful book. And the exhibition upstairs. Two people missing from the team, actually, Anna Marie, I mentioned, and also Ian Boyd-White, who is Professor of Architectural History at Edinburgh University and helped with the translation and also wrote the foreword. So just to give an example, this is the work of Riach and Hall, who have been shortlisted for the Sterling Prize the last 2 years. So a contemporary practice, but whose work is very modest. It's very deliberately restrained. And at first they were quite bemused by our interest in them at all, because they said, we don't really do colour. It's all kind of material-based or shades of grey, very, very soft colours. But we were very keen to include a material-based palette and also to prove that colour doesn't have to be colourful to be colour. It still is colour. And it's part of the composition. So what emerged from their work was two threads in their work. One was buildings of the light, so low northern light that we get in Scotland, and the interaction with the landscape. And secondly, dark, charred buildings in shadow. So we decided to concentrate on these two buildings, Forth Valley College and Bannockburn. The strategy which emerged we called hushed tonalities. Hushed is a very specific word. So it's not about being mute. It's not saying that this architecture says nothing. Quite the opposite. It speaks quietly. It deliberately is even made more quiet by the application of colour. For instance, on the woodwork, it's actually overpainted with a thin white see-through stain. So there's a sense that not only are they aware of the softness, but they're making it even softer. It's like it's an underlay or a primer, an architectural primer to the activity that takes place. And then tonalities comes from these gentle shifts in the softness of the colours. And also I think we can explain here the fact that this is an experiential measurement. So if you go up close to the brick, there is only two colours of brick, a pale grey and a dark grey. But as you walk back, you actually experience six different tones because of the ways the patterns are mixed. So that gives us the sense of mixing. So then the task was how to convey these findings in a way which was appropriate to the medium. And we have based the output on two different types of painting, both of which are collaged, so original assembled collages of the painted panels. The first method is by what we call building portraits. Now, just like any portrait, the buildings here should be recognisable, should have a sense of the characteristic of the building, but we didn't want to just do a sort of palette of saying, well, this colour is here and so on. We wanted to give more information. So although these are very abstract, they actually locate where the colours were sourced, so in a hierarchy from ground, middle to roof, as you go up the paintings. And then also they look at the extent and relationships and proportion of the colours. So here we see an extraordinary contrast between the outside and inside of the Bannockburn building, this very, very monochrome exterior, and then a soft interior with highlights of copper and leather. The strategy here is projected by a drawing which we call visualizations. And this was really challenging. It's very challenging to me as an architect, because what we were trying to do is make drawings of spaces that don't exist. So none of these spaces actually exist in reality. They're abstracted based on what we were experiencing as the color strategy. So here, the drawing is trying to explain light and shadow, the inclusion of the landscape into the work, and so forth, the highlights of the copper, and then these modulations in tone. I mentioned that we chose two buildings and two architects in Edinburgh, in Zurich, and in Berlin. And in Berlin, one of the architects was Hans Scheroen. And again, I think we've uncovered a lot of original information on his work. Really, colour is just ignored in most books. There's very little documentation on it. So here we have the Staatsbibliothek in Berlin, which many of you will know. And having looked and researched the colour, it's a very broad palette. There's a lot of colour in that building. And yet it has a sense of calmness, a sort of intellectually calm place, but also stimulating. So it's not just bland white. The colour is used to give this little level of stimulation at the same time. And the more you look, the more there's colour in the recesses and in the shadows. Whereas the Berlin Philharmonie, just adjacent to it, has this very much warmer, enclosing, theatrical palette, which again is a sort of celebration of being together, if you like. So the portraits are about taking the raw data, which is the colour, and then assembling them in this sort of an idea of how the colour is situated in relation to each other. The strategy in relation to Hans Scheroen we called holistic interplay. In his work, everything is integral, so it's completely holistic. The use of the colour, the form, and so on, it's completely integrated. And it's integrated in relation to the function of the buildings as well. So it's a highly skillful composition. Now, the Basil Spence work exemplified another problem, which is that obviously when you go back, there are very few photographs in colour of the buildings at the time, and they may have been overpainted many times. And so that demanded a different technique. So we chose two housing projects in Edinburgh by Basil Spence. And here what we had to do was look at archives, interview. The job architect is actually walking up the road in that 1960s picture. It's Richard Cassidy, and he's now 94, but incredibly lucid, and was very helpful. Actually, I don't know if Antoni Blee is here. See, we're expecting him perhaps this afternoon, but hopefully he's also one of Basil Spence's partners, so I'm looking forward to speaking to him. So it's a different methodology. We had to do scrapes and so on to try and establish what the colours were like. In the case of Basil Spence, there's also a sense of that post-war optimism. So you see these very lively palettes of mustard and ochre and slate greys and so on, but also an interest in vernacular colour taken on the outside of the building on the right. For Spence, the use of colour is about clarifying the tectonics. So here the strategy is about almost an anatomical reading of buildings, codifying one element against another so that some colours will come forward, some will recede, and you're really identifying the structural systems in the project. So again, the idea of these strategies is that they're not unique to these buildings, is that we're suggesting that you could take them as an architect, apply that strategy to another project and say, actually, that's what I want to do with the colour. I want to do something that's going to clarify its meaning in this way. Whereas a very contemporary architectural practice in Zurich, Knappewerz and Fickert, use colour in a completely different way. It's I wouldn't say dishonest, but the whole point is that it's a mask. It's using colour in support of illusions. So what they'll do is apply colour as a second layer, and that's our reading of the strategy here. So, for instance, this housing project plays games with the facade, and it changes the scale of the project just simply by the way in which the colour is applied. Or it might support a particular reading which is not exactly clear. So it's part of an architectural conceptual device. And then the earliest example that we worked with is a woman architect from Switzerland, Lutz Guier, who's one of the first practicing architects, women architects. And her work was really very sophisticated. What we call this painterly promenade, because the colour in this instance is working completely in a spatial dimension and in time. So it invites you to move through from one space to the other. And again, none of these spaces actually exist. They're fictive spaces, but they're trying to represent the way in which the colour is used within the projects. And then we're going to hear from Nicholas in a minute about Alvar's work. And I think here we're seeing this a really clear understanding of the interaction of colours in a composition, but in three dimensions while you're moving along. So finally, perhaps the one that will punch out at you literally is a strategy we called immersive pop. And this is by the Berlin architect Rainer Rümmler, who was responsible for the design of a number of the underground lines in Berlin. And you can probably guess the date of this, around about 1970s in this case. And here, the composition of the portraits is the only portraits which go horizontally. And that was because we wanted you to feel the experience of the colour as you actually experience it in the train. And it's this intensive, stripy, sort of horizontal speed of movement. And the immersive pop comes because of pop art, populist, and it also pops out at you. And immersive is because, first of all, it's almost a psychedelic experience. It's really intense. And you're also underground, so it's this amazingly intense experience. So this strategy effectively defies, sometimes some people would say it defies taste, but it certainly defies fashion, and it plays with these games of mainstream taste and so forth. The spaces are highly recognizable and very distinctive, so it's almost like a branding. So that's where I'm going to end. The exhibition and the book are, I think, a celebration of analog techniques. So everything is made by hand. I hope you will go up and peer really closely and see and enjoy the work. And I hope you'll find it interesting. Thank you.
So it's my honor to speak to you in the capacity of someone who knew these two great artists very well, Annie and Joseph Albers. And clearly the break was to give you a chance to stretch and chat or something else, and to give me a chance to go to the bathroom. And when I did so, I found myself thinking of a moment when I once asked Annie Albers, what did it take to succeed at the Bauhaus? And she said, oh, you know, she arrived and she asked someone at the front desk in Weimar in 1922, how does one succeed at this school? And the person replied, you go down the hall, you turn left. Go down that hall, then you turn right, and you go to your third door on the left. And she did all of that, and the door that she arrived at simply had one word on it, which was pull. So maybe it took pull to succeed at the Bauhaus, maybe it took push, as it did here, but in any case, I found myself thinking, Fiona, that Annie and Joseph would have just been fascinated to hear you. They would have loved it. And I'm also aware that one of the great thinkers of our times is in this room today, a man named Roger Kneebone, who's a surgeon and philosopher and commentator on many things. And he's had me thinking a lot recently about the idea of conversation. Conversation rather than the idea of each of the five of us coming up and speaking about something. And I was dying to engage in a conversation with you and make it about responses and exchange and growth. And unfortunately, of course, I have my images and my program in mind. But as you were talking about color strategies, in many ways, I was thinking about people about whom I've written and whom I've studied who very much had no strategy and no formula. And I wrote a biography of Le Corbusier, and I was fascinated to know that after he'd worked on many of the buildings in Chandigarh and he'd done the High Court, he kept asking all of his fellow architects, and it was the man who worked with him at Chandigarh who told me this, that every day Corbu would ask the same question: should I put color on the entrance columns? And every day the architects would say, absolutely not, pure plaster. And Corbu would appear to listen. And then after 3 weeks, one day he got up and had the people working for him put the three colors of the Indian flag on the three columns, and that was that. And Joseph Albers, when asked, how do you paint? First, always inclined toward the practical, liked to reply, the way I spread butter on bread. And then he tended to talk to one about why he preferred pumpernickel to other types of bread. But if he got back to the issue of how he painted and how he chose colors, he would say, well, you know, if he wanted to use a particular yellow, he would try a Winter Newton Mars yellow. If that didn't work, a Grumbacher Mars yellow, maybe a Block X Mars yellow. But in fact, everything worked. There were no systems. Everything was beautiful to him. And he said he would look up and finally just thank God for the whole thing. And I'm now writing a biography of Mondrian, which is one of the greatest treats one can imagine after a lot of years of looking at beautiful abstract art. And of course, he was forever changing the pure colors on the walls of his room. And here you have Annie and Joseph. And I know that it's a black and white photo, but it's essentially taken by Cartier-Bresson, by the way. But it's also, it was a black and white house. They lived in whiteness. There were only four paintings with color in the whole house. And what a privilege it is to show you today and try to give you the perspective on color in architecture of these two momentous artists. You have Annie, an intrepid woman who went to the Bauhaus at age 22. When she was 22, and I'm excited to tell you all, there will be a major Annie Albers retrospective at Tate Modern at the end of 2018. This woman who, on her own, having grown up with brocades and damasks and everything ornate, developed a passion for straight lines and pure solid color as a source of emotional balance to her, as you see in this rug design that she made when at the Bauhaus. And you have Joseph, who made his way from a very poor background in an industrial city, where he told me that the coal smoke was so intense that even his spit was black. And he was fascinated with black and white from the very beginning. This is his earliest extant drawing, which I found after he died. He died in 1976. And if you look at the view that he did from the window of the little place where he lived as a school teacher in the village of Stadtlohn, you'll see that some of the window panes are black with white mullions, others are white with black mullions. There's no practical reason for it. It's play. It's playfulness. His earliest memory of childhood was walking, being with his mother at the post office, and while waiting for her, he walked, as many of us do as kids, between the black and white tiles on a checkerboard floor. It was all about playfulness, and at the same time, Albers always called himself a frustrated architect. He was fascinated with Gothic architecture, as you see in this drawing of the Cologne Cathedral. He did drawings out of books, studying the proportions of architecture. He photographed and collected postcards of the things that most appealed to him and made photo collages. A big show of these photo collages is opening up at the Museum of Modern Art in New York in a couple of weeks. And starting in January, which tends not to be the brightest time of the year in London, there will be a show here at the David Zwirner Gallery called Sunny Side Up, which are Joseph's paintings essentially in yellow. He saw color as a source of great joy from the time that he was a very young man. Now, most people are unaware, first of all, that Joseph was a devout Catholic, which definitely had an impact on his artistic approach. And even before he went to the Bauhaus, he worked in stained glass and made this very celebrative window and was fascinated with the way that light passed through colored glass, which to him had a religious and a spiritual power. The original of the window was destroyed. We've had it remade. We lend it to exhibitions because it's a very important aspect of his work. And with his love for color in architecture, he did fantastic windows at a museum in the same city where Bach was organ master. This meant a lot to Joseph, the idea of the systems of Bach, the sheer beauty and power of movement and rhythm in the windows that he made while he was at the Bauhaus, using black and white for the richest possible interplay. His love for architecture went beyond modernism completely. So many different cultures. He photographed a great deal of the Aztec and Inca cultures and their architecture in Mexico and Peru. Movement was everywhere. The qualities of black, white, and gray were everywhere for him. And then he did paintings in which he took some of the spirit, some of the ideas that he saw in Mexican architecture, and in pure colors, paint straight out of the tube, applied with a painter's knife, not a palette knife, but a painter's knife. Joseph insisted on that distinction. He would somehow refer back to some of the architecture that he most loved. This spectacular painting called Tenayuca certainly gives one the illusion of overlapping colors, translucency and transparency, but it's entirely an illusion. Joseph always found the paint to give you the illusion, and every paint that you're looking at there was straight out of the tube, applied with a knife on the white background. You were never looking at a paint on top of another paint. Illusion and magic was what came with color and line. You could take nothing but horizontal lines and vertical lines and established architectural movement and shades of gray. Now, Albers did at times have color systems. He showed me this painting when he was in his mid-80s and I was in my mid-20s. What a treat. Imagine, after lots of years of academia, to be face to face with Joseph Albers, who had a passion for getting me to see color and understand its magic and its power. And I'm going to ask all of you the same question that Joseph asked me in front of this very painting. Please don't answer yet, but consider the question. First of all, Joseph would have the caveat, no word really explains a color. But we use names in order to have a way of describing them. So consider the yellow, the pink, the purple, and the dark red. And then Joseph asked me, which color is there in the greatest quantity? He really asked me, most genuine, simple question, which is there in the greatest quantity? And at a given moment, I'm going to ask you, please, could you just call out, each and every one of you, which color is there in the greatest quantity? Yellow. Now, yellow, red, what else? Purple? Equal. Did I hear pink?
Pink.
Pink, thank you. So Joseph said to me, you know, if you have 25 people in a room, you have four colors, you better get four different answers at least, because color is not a fact. Color is something about our perception. Color is our relationship to it. And he said, many people think here that it's yellow. But yellow, he said, Joseph was a school teacher. He used to teach in a one-room school. And he said that yellow would be like the loud kid in the class, where because he was loud, you sort of were more aware of his presence. But that didn't really mean that he was any bigger. And then Joseph explained to me that he had worked out a system whereby he used exactly the same number of square centimeters of each color. So it is equal. And if you think that the sort of maroon that's surrounded by pinks in the middle vertical slits is not quite the same as it is in the outer precincts of the painting, that is what Fiona was talking about, which is the impact of one color on another, so that it appears darker in the pink surrounds. And the pink appears to be a blend of other colors and therefore not necessarily as strong. But Joseph, at age 85, with that shock of white hair, said to me, this is my madness, Nick. This is my insanity. But I love the system, and then I love disproving it. And so he really took color to magical places with reference to architecture. He called those paintings his adobes, referring to the architecture that he loved in the American Southwest and in Mexico. He was openly influenced by the colors of Mexican folk art, which he found very spontaneous and natural. And the resultant work is simply poetic. Color itself has the quality to calm you, to lighten you, to make your day better. Now, I can't help it. Politics is, or the events of the world are on our minds desperately at the moment. And when I think of color in architecture, I think of walls. And writing about Mondrian, I've read a theory that Mondrian, his whole life, created walls to replace things he didn't want to see with what he wanted to see. And then this morning, when I thought I'd sort of heard it all, my wife told me that she'd just gotten an email from a friend of hers with a child in a school in Minnesota, Minneapolis. And the child was 10 years old and went to school and discovered that in the classroom, a lot of kids had taken blocks and built a wall and said it was to keep the Hispanic students out. And I thought, you know, we're now in a world where we're talking about walls in a different way than we were talking about walls or thinking we had to take walls seriously a week ago. And my only conclusion, or perhaps my only hope, is that you as architects, you whatever you do, we whatever we do, instead of letting walls be barriers, make them beautiful and add beauty everywhere and try to provide spirit where it might otherwise really be taken out of the world. And those of us working as I do in an essentially Muslim country feel even more of a need to try to help the people who are being put behind negative walls and use color, use everything within our power, everything we have to create beauty and sanity and hope in the world. Now, Joseph came to a particular format for color when he was 62 years old in his Homages to the Square, certainly a well-known body of work. And as I said, he always painted with a knife on a white background because white is what allowed color to emerge in its greatest purity. And he told me that never putting a color on top of another, he always started in the middle and worked his way out because his father taught him that when you paint a door, if you start at the middle and work your way out, you catch the drips and you don't get your cuffs dirty. And Joseph did every homage to the square under two sets of lighting conditions. One had fluorescent bulbs arranged warm, cold, warm, cold. Another warm, cold, cold, warm. The difference was subtle enough so that he wanted to look at every painting under both sets of lights. And then he took that format and used color and color alone to create incredible moods, different forms of movement, different sense of spirit, to make boundaries disappear, corners disappear, and to experiment endlessly. And then he used color in architecture very specifically, by at times having his work realized as murals, as you see here. And he was a great fan of Barragán, with whom he was a friend, understandably. I mean, you're mainly architects. Joseph Albers knew everyone who was at the Bauhaus, of course, Gropius, Mies, and Breuer, but Barragán was really his favorite of the architects he knew. And one of the reasons was this just beautiful poetic use of color, this magical impact that we see in Barragán's work. But many people think that they've seen a painting by Albers in Barragán's house. And certainly, if you only know Barragán's architecture from reproductions, you assume that it's a painting by Albers. But it was an authorized fake that Joseph allowed his friend Barragán to do, and he was honored that Barragán did it. And he worked with architects at times just to use black, white, and gray to expand the quality of walls, to make walls a source of diversion and openness, as you see here in different projects that he realized. And I also want to say to all of you, it's not too late to take ideas of Joseph and Annie Albers, consult with our foundation, and go further, because they loved the idea of their visual thinking being realized in architecture. Joseph was mightily proud when Gropius had him do a mural that was seen by 500,000 people a day because everyone going in and out of Grand Central Station in New York passed it. It's now been taken down. We're trying to have it rebuilt. But it certainly showed the power of color and line to infuse daily life with unexpected pleasure. And shadows meant so much to him, the way things changed with daylight, as in these walls. And this is one of his walls at Stanford University, a marvelous creation where both sides of it, and this one is clearly reflective, are sources of great beauty and playfulness. So architecture was his favorite vehicle for the realization of form. The shapes that he put over a museum in Munster, the same town where he had drawn the cathedral as a young man and taken photographs. He loved the idea of using line to create impossible shapes. You think you're going into them one way, then another, and they flip-flop as you look. Magic and alchemy is what intrigued Joseph Albers more than anything else. He worked with the architect Harry Seidler, one of his favorite students, on this mural for a building in Sydney, Australia. Built murals in the Corning Glass Building, and this, which was in the Time Life Building in New York. Adding color and form to architecture was a vital thing for Joseph Albers. And then we look at Annie, this magnificent artist who said to me that when Paul Klee talked to her about taking a line for a walk, she thought about taking thread everywhere that she could. And she too used color in architecture and wanted to work with architects. This is a study she made for a rug intended for the Time Life Building in New York. You just saw Joseph's murals there. She took the design and worked on it in various colors. For Annie, art was a visual resting place, a diversion, the only possible source of sanity and joy in her very complicated life. And working on that Time Life rug, which has never been realized and should be realized, she imagined on a large scale the impact of playfulness and line and color on everyday life. We're jumping here back to Joseph for a moment for one of his projects for Paul Rudolph at the Yale School of Architecture. Again, geometric form related to building. And if you look very carefully at this brick wall, which he did for the architect King Louis Wu in New Haven at a building called Manuscript, you'll see the way that the subtle nuances, and Fiona, some of your slides very much related to this in a way, the great subtlety that can have such an impact on our everyday experience. And he worked with Marcel Breuer on stained glass for one of Breuer's church. This was Joseph's study for it, but you can see it's a rejected design. By the way, he stopped speaking with Breuer over this collaboration, but one could do an entire lecture on architects Joseph Albers stopped speaking with because of collaborations gone wrong. And the one for Breuer was one of them. The ones with King Louis Wu were more felicitous, as in this beautiful fireplace design for which Joseph made little studies in wood. He's quite old when he did this, and he loved the way that light played with shadow. And here we are actually back in Barragan land again with another reproduction. Now, I can't help but just give you a moment of Le Corbusier, because the impact of color at Roneshaw is in itself utterly breathtaking. There's nothing to equal the sheer joy that he put into pure color. Matisse as well. You take a plain white space and you animate it with color. And I have to say that looking at this and speaking to you about Joseph and Annie Albers, one of the greatest personal moments of my life was seeing at a moment when she was very, very happy, and an editor in New York, Jackie, who then used the last name of Kennedy again, but had been Onassis, but arriving at the Albers' house. And here you had the woman who had lived in the White House, I mean, everything that Jackie Kennedy was, going to see Annie Albers, the last remaining great artist of the Bauhaus. Jackie walked in. She'd been antiquing with my wife. She was in sort of a baggy sweater and old pants with holes in them and ravishing looking, and walked into this very, very simple house of the Alberses, as plain as could be. And the first thing she said, it was almost too cute for words, she looked at Annie Albers and she said, "Oh, Mrs. Albers, I lived in a White House once also." But then Annie greeted her as she might a student and said, Mrs. Onassis, she did use Onassis, Mrs. Onassis, have you heard of the Bauhaus? And Jackie, who was in her great good schoolgirl mode, said, oh, Mrs. Halpers, it is such an honor to meet you. But then she said something which showed such vision, I could hardly believe my ears. She looked at the four homages to the square that were the only paintings in the Albers' house, everything else pure white, and she said, just like Matisse's chapel in Vence, all the white and then the color. Mm-hmm. And at that moment, you knew that she really saw, she really got it. Philip Johnson did an Annie Albers show at the Museum of Modern Art, used some of Annie's materials for his own architecture, installed her work to rare effect. The collaboration of Annie with architects was vital to her, particularly manifest in Philip's clever installation of her work at MoMA. She liked working for Camino Real Hotel and did this great textile that was hanging in Mexico City for many years. She collaborated with an architect in Dallas to do arc panels using brilliant colors to cover the Torah scrolls. And for Annie, this was quite fascinating because although she always knew that she was Jewish, and as she would say in the Hitler sense, Jewish, she had been baptized in the Carl Wilhelm Gedächtniskirche, and yet her family had been forced out of Germany. She knew that she was recognized as a Jewish artist in America, and she took great delight in putting such joy into these arc panels for that synagogue in Dallas. And this is why I go back to the idea that there are still ways of realizing her work very, very impressively. Look at the impact of her color there within the congregation. Now, there are works by Annie that she did as architectural commissions, like these wall hangings for a late Philip Johnson building, the AT&T building, that were realized on a very large scale and added color impressively to the architectural space. And then I wanted you to consider the way that various architects have installed her work. Guy Olenti did a spectacular installation of Annie's work at the Peggy Guggenheim in Venice, and subsequently in Paris and the Jewish Museum. And although Guy's work, by my standards, could be all over the place, in the case of Annie Albers, Guy studied that work so carefully as an architect. She spent days looking at it. She spent days on each installation. She created this furniture just to show Annie Albers' materials. And I think she did great justice to an artist she very much admired. And installation is such a vital thing, and the impact of Guy's choices for Annie Albers in this room, which related Annie and Joseph, made a great difference in an art show. More recently, the brilliant architect Toshiko Mori dealt with the very difficult space of the Cooper Hewitt Museum in New York to install Annie and Joseph's work in a show that put together their designs for everyday living. Joseph's furniture, Annie's wall hangings, more of Joseph's furniture, and wall hangings and drapery materials, none of which have been adequately used in the architectural world, but that were shown to great advantage because of this extremely sensitive installation by Toshiko Mori. There are still products being made that take Annie Albers' designs and realize them on a large architectural scale, some of which will be shown at Tate Modern. I couldn't resist this photo although it was thrown in by someone who works for me, but it's the only time Annie was in London in 1990 when she got the highest honor at the Royal College of Art and told me that the ceremony was the three most boring hours she'd ever experienced. But they were people who loved playing with form, playing with color, making art. There's so much more that we can do with their wonderful vision. What you're looking at here is something yet to be seen by most people. It's the floor at the new headquarters of the great London choreographer, Wayne McGregor. It's an example of the collaborative ventures that are still to be done with these great artists. See some of Annie's drawings and how they can be realized architecturally. It's magic. The Albers' work is magic in so many ways. And we end by looking at one of the purest uses of color one could imagine. It was January of 1976. Joseph was 87 years old. I arrived at his house one day and said, "How are you today, Mr. Albers?" "Not good, Nick." "What's the problem?" "Well, I'm trying to do a particular painting, and I must have the central square large. And when I do studies for it with the central square small, everything is fine. The interaction of color occurs. You get the penetration of one color into another. You get everything that I want. You get the glow. But I want the central square large. And my problem is that with studies, I've realized that I can achieve it if I could only find Winsor Newton cobalt green from batch 195. And now the only thing we can find is batch 204. And I said, "Oh, I'll do my best, Mr. Albers." And I started calling every art supply store in Connecticut, and no one had batch 195. And as you know, Winsor Newton, located not so far from here, but I called the head of the American branch, New Jersey, got the president of American Winsor Newton on the phone, and said that I was desperately trying to find cobalt green number 195 for someone who was dissatisfied with cobalt green number 204. And the man on the phone said, "There's no difference. We at Winsor Newton keep our colors on point." And I said, "Well, sir, I'm calling for Joseph Albers." "Joseph Albers?" And 2 days later, a box arrived at 808 Birchwood Drive with five tubes of Winsor Newton cobalt green from batch 195. And Joseph painted, 87 years old, this glorious painting. And he said to me, "You see, Nick, the blue is the cosmos. And then you have the sea and you have the sky. You have the sea and you have the earth. And really, I have to have the colors right because the cosmos should not have boundaries. It shouldn't have sharp points. We don't want corners. Everything must have the same light intensity. We want the glow. We want the magic." And he said, "I have to do it with the large central square. I wasn't satisfied with the small central square because the cosmos is getting nearer and nearer." It was the last painting he made. He died that March, a robust man until his 88th birthday. And I think that's how we have to think of color, as cosmic and magical. Thanks.
So I just wanted to say thank you very much to Nicholas Fox Weber, and also to Fiona. I didn't say that after your presentation, but what an incredible amount of beauty and joy and invention. If you can't get inspired by that, then I don't know what would inspire you. This next presentation, I'm sure, is going to be just as exciting and inspirational. Please welcome Eric Parry.
Thank you. Well, this compared with that is, I think, going to be very messy. So I apologize, but it's I'm really describing a process of the discovery of possibilities in a way, both materially and indeed through the idea of color in architecture. Using one project, and part of the dialogue is also between architect and artist, which I'll come to explain in some detail, working on a project with Richard Deacon. But in terms of material, ceramic, you know, is, or terracotta here with this amazing Picasso piece, is about both the domestic and the architectural. So at the scale of building, there is a critical issue which is very much to do with longevity. This is a beautiful piece by Richard Deacon called Fold, which are a series of trapezoidal shaped pieces on a core. The glaze is fantastic. He worked particularly with his ceramic pieces with a studio in Cologne. And the other question I'm asked when, but this particular firing and so on is not suitable for exterior purposes, so it's not a bow ceramic, as it were. However, obviously, there's a fantastic, when I'm asked how long does, how long does a glaze last, one just needs to point to the something like the Ishtar Gate here in Berlin, to realize that it is like glass, it is baked, it's hard, and it's incredibly enduring when it comes to color. My own first exploration with glazes was to work in, this is a small project for a studio space, an experimental space at Wimbledon School of Art, finished many years ago now. But it involved brick elements and then the north-lit studios, very low because of neighboring buildings, but working with an artist called John Mitchell, sadly no longer here with us, but a wonderful man. And we were trying to work from his graphic and his paintings into an architectural territory with the tessellation of brick and using glazes of a different intensity of blue and this red. So it emerged in the wall at the Wimbledon School of Art. With a firm called Shores of Darwin. And the next, but the first sort of moment actually of working with Richard Deacon was an intention that I had to include a piece by him on a building in Finsbury Square, which is a load-bearing stone building. And actually, the composition of the facade was about this chain proposal he had of balls of ceramic on a core of stainless steel, which sadly we didn't tie into the planning process enough, and the it became excluded. So it was a failed relationship. But at the same time, I was discovering things about Richard's work, not least of which was this incredible viscosity that he was achieving on very large pieces of ceramic, which gave a clue to what might have been on this building, and sadly wasn't. On the other hand, you get a kind of a bee going buzzing about materials. And when I came to do a project for a little museum in Bath, an extension, which you can see to the right, in an attempt to open up the building to the gardens behind it, as an extension, it was playing against stone in a garden setting. In fact, the only extant outline of a 18th century pleasure garden. Wondering how to create the opposite of stone upon stone going from those urns to the rusticated base, because I had to have a blind wall at the top for an exhibition space. So it was reversing with ceramic and ceramic behind glass and then glass and glass at the bottom that created an end to this great street, Great Pulteney Street, that was the entrance to the pleasure garden. And again, working with Shores of Darwin, began to think about the elements and how they would be glazed. I'm not going through the whole story, but this is the process of casting and finishing, not extruding ceramic. And then discovering, because the question of depth was very important in that foliate setting, the idea of a single fired but twice glazed surface, which would give depth rather than the consistent finish. So this is what I would say, you know, is very much a crafted use of glaze and glazing. You can see the viscosity on this as well, using a manganese underneath and then a titanium on top that is sprayed and and found by accident, in fact, as a air pressure on the spraying machine got to the point of spatter, so you didn't completely cover the surface. But it then found its way into this tripartite organization of the elevation, as I say, from solid ceramic at the top to a veiling of it below. So this is the finished piece. And of course, glass and glazing, and glazing to faience, very intimately related. They have this fantastic quality of reflection and movement, because in the setting, when the tree moves, the shadow moves, and so the building becomes animated. But that's by way of getting to the point of difference here in the project I'm going to show. Which is, I don't have a pointer, I guess, do I know, is a block that you can see. I kind of described it as urban dental decay. So it's the top block. It's if I do this, you can see it's there. And it's this section. And it's actually the rebuilding of that whole block to reorder it. That this is a site at Piccadilly Circus that is owned by the Crown Estate, and they because of their leasing, every 100 years, you get the possibility of renewal. And it's kind of interesting that the state of the street was like this. So you had a waterhouse bank. You can just see you've got Waterstones, the wonderful building with its horizontality. You then have a funny eclectic building, which you can see at the bottom, maybe, is Barron's, the outfitters. So Baron Cohen, his father, actually. So here, with this strange overcladding of what was a very ornate late Victorian corbelled corner speaking to the waterhouse. And then you can see the cornice at the intersection. So Norman Shaw laying this down, an architect called Blomfield, kind of working with all the great Piccadilly buildings that, you know, start maybe with the Ritz, with the idea of a cornice height. So you can see the precipitous drop at this point between the corner and then these flanking intermediate buildings. And it was an unfinished story. So there was a sense in the 20s that they were going to make the first boulevard in London of Piccadilly. But then they came to a recession, and clearly, you know, there's that precipitous drop and the leasing, no doubt. So so this was a little sketch that I produced to suggest that a new building might take up those three buildings that you see rising, coming to the corner. But and Westminster is a tricky place to get a planning permission. So this is shortening a very lengthy story of that. But you can just see that I had an idea about those double height openings as a grand part of. So I'm kind of behaving with the horizon line of the cornice and the double order, which is very much what Blomfield was dealing with. And that you can see an idea of a blush in those cheeks and some idea on the cornice of an artwork. And then the corner building, which actually we took down stone by stone, stored, and put back up, remaking the base of the building and elevating it a little bit so that it would work. So this is a mask to an office building that filled that void that you saw. And it's interesting. Also, at this point, I was definitely thinking of ceramic, but a ceramic like a jug white, so a simple, because I wanted to use ceramic here in a much more artificial way than the crafted ceramic that I showed you at the Hoban. Artifice, an artwork, a polychromatic work, and let's see where we go with it. And this was a drawing I produced at that point, which suggested that actually the cornice might be, I was just filling it in, actually, and it was regular. Some idea of shadow and working into it, and that the blush of these recesses would actually be mark-making. And so that one is working with a depth of wall and a sense of scaling of the ceramic elements, which is terribly important in the joints. And just thinking about it as taking its part in a very strange and eclectic world, because it is half an urban block, as it were, that we were dealing with. And it's just worth remembering, this is the state of that. There are five facades. So there's a retained facade in German Street, which now has residential units behind it, flats. A corner in New Portland Stone, another artwork actually by another artist called Stephen Cox. And then on the corner, the old facade that's brought back and has incredible life in it, this beautiful stonework. And then the 25 meters of the new facade, which would include the Richard Deacon cornice. And this is the interesting thing with ceramic that is cast. Oh, that's fine. Thank you. Yeah, great. Because it's an expensive material, but it can be repeated. So this just shows you that sectionally there's a complexity, but it is repeated through the six bays of the facade. The other thing that has to be, if you're not going to create a kind of the tragedy of a rain screen with open joints, it has to be a very stiff substrate in order that you can use a lime mortar. And by the time Richard got involved, it became clear that you couldn't have the clash of two personalities. So I began to think of the blush that I was very sure I wanted on the body of the building being a much more mechanistic idea. So it is the program here of moving from solid color to broken color in the cheeks of those double elements. So enter Richard and a competition. First of all, I set up a competition and for the Crown Estate, who don't have internally, you know, an art strategy or a board to look at that. I suggested they take on two, very significant voices from the art world. So Richard Cork and Paul Morehouse from National Portrait Gallery joined to help with those sort of issues that Fiona was talking about. You know, I mean, how you make a kind of decision. And there were six sculpted variants, but Richard's, this developed after the competition, I have to say. So one was taking, you know, it was a question of trust, of working together, because it's your kind of body, if you will. And a sculptor like Richard's very used to placing a sculpture on a surface, but to actually share the body is kind of interesting, I think, and requires an extraordinary degree of trust on both sides. But he came up with this proposal for a series of facets that would be of a different form. So there are 39 elements with variants of, as you can see, I think it was about 13, that had to be then made into pieces of ceramic that were transportable and would be would hold together. And Shores of Darwin, some of these pieces are up to 200 kilograms. What they did, sadly, they're in demise, but, you know, they used to make Belfast sinks of heavy pieces of cast ceramic. So they were too big to be in one piece, and so they had to be made up as a series. And this is the combinations that Richard determined for these dentals, these sort of extraordinary pieces, the 39, that would work into the 25 meters of the facade. And at the same time, going back a bit, he had been working with this idea, which was a bit like, you know, the work of Scagliola, where you're mixing plasters. He was baking the mix and cutting these to form pieces. The problem was that it would be impossible to make the body out of this material. And the glazing of this was incredibly difficult. So he then turned to making this series of colored mark makings. This is drawn together rather neatly at the end of the process, but these were the pieces that we had to then, according to his numeration and setting of adjacencies, get onto the ceramic. And this is one of the dry lays on, that's Richard actually in the middle, you can just see with his head popping up behind this. This is a dry lay in Lancashire of this. It's very much easier said than done, lots of rejections, because what we were working with was, we could have done it in two ways, suggesting this to Richard. One was that he wasn't going to paint all these pieces, but he could have had artists in the studio painting onto the surfaces and then having them fired. Or there was the other transposition, which was to take crockery and the idea of transfer. So if any of you remember, you know, making models and putting decals on, it's kind of like that you take the transfer from crockery that was coming out of Stoke-on-Trent, out of a tiny little maker, and having to equate, to get the intensity of color, so lots of failures, an equivalence between the kilns of the transfer fabricator in Stoke-on-Trent and the manufactory in Darwin. And eventually, the failures reduced, and it got to a point that Richard was happy with the intensity that we were getting on the elements. So that was the process. And one remembers, you know, if you walk around ruins, it is kind of amazing when you meet a cornice on the ground, because it's huge. And yet when it's lifted into the air, you know, it becomes relatively insignificant. It's this wonderful thing of scale. So the other thing was how the building was made. As I say, it had to be very stiff. So this is not a steel frame. It's a steel encased in concrete and stitched together, so you don't get movement. So there's a lot of technical work in how you are able to place this in a traditional masonry way with lime mortar, because the lime mortar allows a little bit of movement, which you can take, but very little. And so it is effectively a very traditional form of making. You can see that goes back to that that drawing of the different types. And of course, you know, tolerance when firing, you get a lot of differences. But yeah, this is the formulation. The gaps are the bits that hadn't worked and had to be put together. And this is how it eventually got put in place. So he called it Piccadilly, and we had a fantastic kind of unveiling on a bus, which is, I think, absolutely appropriate to an artwork being, you know, given its first showing. But it this is a very short description of a process that is very uncertain in the beginning, except for the way in which the building might sit in the street, that you can see maybe if you would go back to that initial sketch, that there's some ideas that have carried through clearly. This is the completely reconstructed building on the corner. As I say, fabulous, a very eclectic, bizarre building, but beautiful stone, Portland stone. And I always had in my mind the artifice, as I talked about, but because of its location, I mean, this is a Piccadilly building, Piccadilly Circus building. And at night, I always knew it's north-facing, so in the London light, you know, it gets a beautiful wash in the summer that just casts down Piccadilly. Otherwise, it's in this rainy world of shadow. So that was the other reason for using the ceramic. But at night, when the lights are on at Piccadilly Circus, of course, they wash over this. So they kind of animate the surface. You just pick it up here. You've got the Coca-Cola sign. You've got this sort of scaling. And at the same time, going back, there's this sort of sense of it as the backdrop. You can, it kind of requiting to some extent that vision of the Edwardians and the early 20th century architects who were, you know, party to the scaling of this and to the making of the circus space as a sort of, with its westward view, it's kind of like the Evening Standard shot of London in a way, which really, the other thing I should say about the artist architect, I showed you that image of the site because it's very complex and there are, as I say, many parts to Eagle Place, the little vanilla that runs by this. The only thing, and that completely shocked Richard when we went up on the scaffolding. That is to say that his entire obsession was with the cornice and the colouring of the cornice. And so in a way, you know, the architect therefore is starting with the pavement as I see it, you know, and the artist starts from this position of no program, of freedom, you know, and we come together at some point. So I think there's room for both voices, you know, obviously, and it's a joy and a privilege, because an artist can take what we work with, which is a kind of industrialized product, if you like, though ceramic and bioceramic, you know, takes that further. But we are putting together parts in a certain way. The artist can take the language and the narrative, create a kind of myth, as I say, a place for dreaming that goes well beyond the ambitions, I think, of the architect, the architect's understanding of materials, particularly colour, in this instance, to create, as he's called it, you know, Piccadilly, the cornice. So that is the story of this particular collaboration, with a will to colour as artifice rather than crafting, and inevitably and crucially linked intimately to the process of making a material. Thank you.
Okay, so I would like to introduce Antoni, who I didn't say anything about in the beginning because I just presume everyone knows Antoni, but you probably haven't maybe necessarily been with us all the 5 years. And if you're just here with us today, Antoni is an artist who has been practicing in London since the early 80s, I believe, and has a sort of a very diverse practice, but there's a kind of a consistent interest in color and line in space. And this has led to him doing a lot of really quite sort of groundbreaking collaborations with architects over the years, with, you know, with notably with Eric Parry, but also with Hayworth Tompkins, on a very, very photographed Sterling Prize-winning theatre. This is one of the recent projects that he did in Liverpool called The Everyman. I'm sure you've seen lots of pictures of that, and very prominently you would have seen his frescoes. He's also, something mentioned in Fiona's presentation, been running for the past 12 years, the only course on colour taught to architecture students in the UK, here at the Architectural Association. And there's a couple of generations of us who are completely indebted to him as young, well, I don't feel that young anymore, architects, who are absolutely fascinated with colour and have been given this sort of incredible passion about it by Antoni over the course of a year. So I'm very, very happy to welcome him again to give a presentation.
Thank you, Adam. Where is, okay. So we are living in a very colorful world, but how it is with many things in globalized economy, the apparent abundance can be quite deceptive, because probably around 90% of what we see of painted or coated surfaces is one and the same microstructure, which is dioxide of titanium, titanium white. And this being a main component, together with chalk, of emulsion paint, it covers the world, and the color is then achieved by tinting this very inexpensive substance of dioxide of titanium. And as you can see, well, dyes, I'm just reminding you, are liquids which attach themselves to molecular or crystalline structures. And then you can have any color, however, the microstructure of this is the same. So it is as if we were eating on daily basis 90%, for example, of flavored tofu or flavored jelly. However, this is the visual world. And so we see all those colors, but they all appear the same because they have the same level of opacity and the same flatness and a kind of grayish tint to it. So, what can we do? This is fairly recent phenomena. This is a section from Wendell Lecher at the BBC building on Portland Place. The building was built and there was one layer of oil paint, probably with zinc white, I would imagine. Then there was a wall, this black line. After that, there were two more coats of this probably zinc white-based paint. And then from probably late 60s, early 70s, the emulsion paint covers everything like a snow. So, of course, maybe sometimes you may want to have such effect, such flatness and kind of gray shadows, but what can we do? In architecture, most architecture nowadays is done in this way with steel, glass, plasterboard, which is painted emulsion paint. So what happens if we just introduce one more different ingredient, which would be also white, but reflective? This is a paint made with mica, which is a natural glass, and so it is reflective. And what happens is that depending on the amount of light reflected off the surface of the mica paint, the white, still white emulsion dots appear either lighter or darker than the background. And this can be happening simultaneously. So depending on the position of the viewer, the situation changes. In this way, the wall is animated. We can think about it in terms of dimensions. You can imagine that the absorbent white paint is one-dimensional because reflects light in one direction, and then metallic or opalescent paint, two-dimensional. So what happens if we take still the same pigments into three-dimensional construct? We can get much more spatial effects. And then what happens if we introduce stronger chromatic values? And also there is a switch to pigments which are interference pigments. I will explain in a minute how it works, but in this way, apart from tonal shifts, we're also getting chromatic shifts, changes. And indeed, a completely new colors begin to appear. In this photo, there is something visible there, which I would describe as red-gray, a kind of color which Wittgenstein, writing 80 years ago, couldn't possibly imagine. Because color perception and also color names change with technology. And when it comes to interference pigments, they are dichromatic. They are bending wavelengths. And this is still the core of it is mica, and then there is also maybe even titanium dioxide, anyhow, metal oxide, micro-engineering. And it all depends on the size of those grooves. As you can see, this is reflected and scattered in three different directions. And of course, in nature, those things do exist. Also on wings of insects or scales of fish. But until recently, we were not able to have those kind of materials to work with. And it's something extremely luminous because there is no light is absorbed there. So the spatial contrasts between the absorbent and this reflective paint are really great. And what we here in our course tend to talk about is the interaction between painted surfaces. In making as if another layer of space, because this is how I see it. We can describe those dichromatic, those interference pigments as three-dimensional in the same way as the metallic are two-dimensional. So then, then we are also looking at reflections on glass, light patches, and other aspects that happen in architectural setting. And then we end up with a full-blown wall painting in architecture. So this is a very ancient discipline. I don't want to talk about painting here. I don't want to talk about iconography or rhetoric of brush marks, but focus on the materiality of pigments and what they do in relation to space. Here at the Mathematical Institute in Oxford, first of all, I painted those walls with mica paint. You can see that panel on the right. And in order to make them the walls very sensitive to light changes, and then painted with pigments, both absorbent and interference pigments on top. So this provides a very dynamic, this makes a very dynamic relationship with the changing light. And in a sense, you can describe color as a movement or dance of electrons, which is triggered by light. With the changing levels of light, the color completely changes because different pigments are activated with different amounts of light. So some are visible in shadow, some are visible in very strong sunlight. And with sometimes with a very strong, there is a very strong reflection of the mica background, and the color in front almost disappears. And all this conspires to influence a very large architectural space, and in a sense, make the space malleable. This kind of interaction of absorbent and reflective colors can be also effective in other projects, in other ways of working. Here is a staircase, Howard Tompkins' plywood staircase, which I painted. Also with combination of those different pigments. And here also is the reflection of one color onto another, which is blending and making a very different journey up and down this staircase. It is something quite theatrical and transformative. And I suppose this kind of approach is also very Venetian. You can see this in Venetian architecture. The movement of the approach to color, to see color as movement, is embedded already in the stones of Venice. And as Paul Hills points out in his brilliant book about Venetian color, it is all to do with observation of the surrounding colors, which are changing all the time. And the reflection of light of the oily lamina of the lagoon, which is not dissimilar to reflection of light of the mother of pearl. This mixing of colors and also very strong reflection of the water in the canals obliterates direct shadow, and therefore Venetians turn to color in order to articulate architectural detail. This, what we see in Venice now, is a pale echo of what was there 500 years ago. All those moldings also used to be painted and gilded, reflecting constantly the light. And apart from the color marbles and gilding, there was another layer of color which was in constant movement. And this is the Venetian render, mixture of lime and earth pigments applied with on very thin layers in order to conduct humidity going up and down the walls. As the humidity traveled up and down the walls, of course, it created those wonderful, strange watercolor-like effects, which were admired for centuries by everybody, and many painters also painted them. And, well, unfortunately, also this is fast disappearing as the modern renders, which are made with quartz, don't conduct humidity in the same way, and they flake off, leaving those horrible scars all over Venice. Combined with a newly discovered chromophobia in Venice, certainly a new thing, this creates, basically changes the city beyond recognition. Another color material, which is fast disappearing, is Venetian glass mosaic. Now, the workshop in Canareggio, Orsoni, can make about 4,000 colors and shades, which are then stored as glass color plates in this color library in Canareggio. And again, all this will be gone within, you know, a decade or two, because there is no demand for it. Any other workshop in the world that produces colored glass maybe makes up to 40 colors. And considering that in most languages we have only about 11 terms to directly name colors, well, that kind of sophistication of 4,000 seems completely unnecessary. So this is the story. However, glass mosaic is an art of light and can so wonderfully articulate enormous areas like San Marco ceilings. But it's so effective and strong that even one line of this material used here by Carlo Scarpa at the Brion Cemetery animates and elevates quite large areas of concrete. It all is really very much related to light and the quality of light. So the same glass mosaic in London struggles to show its colors and therefore needs additional light in order to perform its colors. This is at the on the Eric Paris elevation. The London light has a real darkness to it, and this darkness is visible in the shadows. And this is an influence of Atlantic. Atlantic is a very dark ocean, and what happens is that there is no algae growing near the surface. The light reflects the dark depths of the ocean. It's a very different story to Pacific, for example, which is much warmer, and there is lots of algae growing near the surface, reflecting the light, and therefore, for example, in Korea, you have lots of very luminous, silvery kind of light, where this kind of color, which in the Far East they always called blue-green, is shining beautifully in the traditional Korean architecture. A similar color used in London here at in Holland Park at Peter Salter's new building has to be metallic in order to be visible and not to disappear into a dark shadow. So the dark shadows call for stronger tonal differences. And this is also visible all over London, the use of white around the windows and any architectural details. However, here at the elevation of the Coin Street building, it was a collaboration with Howard Tompkins. I color designed, but also painted, hand-painted the inner wall. There are several things happening. The colors of the elevations, which are enameled onto textured glass, it's a combination of different temperatures. Because we have to remember that warm colors come forward as when there is a warmer light. And there is a color sympathy. And then if you have cool light, the cooler colors come forward. In a city like London, where all this is changing all the time, it's very important to have those two aspects. And then the dark wall behind, which of course creates depth. I also painted with metallic dark blue. So the metallic paint reflects light and reflects a lot of light, in fact. So it counteracts the reflection of light on the float glass in front. So it is constantly active and doesn't disappear into the dark shadows. At night, a very simple lighting system is just lighting the wall behind. Everything changes, everything flips, both tonally and chromatically. This kind of interaction of colors, well, it's possible to do on such smaller scale. Sometimes it's very difficult to achieve something like this on larger buildings. However, some years ago, I worked with Arup engineers, and we developed spandrels for elevations with optical glass. that was refracting the color, which was just ordinary enamel background. But this was, in a sense, color engineering on macro scale. And indeed, it did work quite well, and you had the movement of color happening on the elevation. All this is really a very ancient story and a dream of dematerializing walls and dematerializing solid surfaces through color and through painting. So when I was asked to work at the Royal Court with Harold Tompkins on the refurbishment of the Royal Court here on Sloane Square, I thought about color and yes, chosen red because, of course, it's a theater, it's a par excellence theatrical color. It works on the sympathetic nervous system and so on. There is an ancient history. But I was looking for something which would enlarge space. And I noticed in Pompeii at the Villa of the Mysteries that the background of that painting enlarges the space. And so I decided that it must be, well, the painting enlarges the space, but somehow there is no any geometrical division of optical division, illusion. So I decided it must be the color. If it's the color, it must be the pigment. And so it is the genuine vermilion. It is a very ancient story. Vermilion, you know, used to be used in caves. I mean, in the form of in its mineral form, which is called cinnabar. And then the Romans used it a lot also in architecture. And it is a very strange substance. It is a fusion of sulfur and mercury, very volatile, and also a very strong color, because if you consider those lighter shapes here, they are, although they appear off-white, but in fact they are quite red, because there is a red mixed into the plaster, but next to vermilion, they just become whatever, off-white. The color doesn't seem to have a, what is called color constancy. So it is shifting all the time between, I don't know, something which is almost purple, almost gray, and then maybe orange. And so this is all the time somehow there is a movement. There is a movement of color. It's sort of unfixed. And maybe this contributes to imagining somehow that the space is larger, because our brain cannot quite fix the boundaries of the wall. And from a distance, it appears very strong. And this is to do with the fact that vermilion reflects only one wavelength, which is red. And everything else that we see around us is a mixture of wavelengths. So our brain is not quite prepared for this information and therefore is alerted by it. When we come closer to it, it sort of almost disappears and dissolves, and we don't quite know where it is anymore, this color. And the ancient Greeks, who in their descriptions of color focus on luminosity, they have already, already the Greeks have noticed that vermilion in a very strong light becomes whiter than white, and in a reduced light becomes darker than black. So it is a very interesting situation. And in terms of linguistic descriptions of color, we have real problem, and that's why as painters we often borrow language of musicians, which is much more precise. And so we could compare vermilion to old, maybe 17th century cello. And a note played on such a cello produces a number of harmonics in a higher register, and at the same time, number of harmonics in a lower register. So in the language of musicians, we can hear the light and the dark at the same time. And it is the reverberation between the two that makes the depth of sound. The German poet Goethe, who also wrote a beautiful, almost phenomenological color theory, Goethe also remarked that thinking is more interesting than knowing, but not than looking. Thank you.
I would back that up. I don't like thinking. It's very tiring. But as an architect, looking always gives you things, and it's ever rewarding. Thank you, Antoni, for those. If anything, I could have even just looked at the slides and enjoyed them, but it was great with the explanations. Next, and unfortunately, finally, we have Joanna Gravunda, who, as I mentioned before, for a long time worked as a partner at Sozzas Associati in Milan. But has an incredible oeuvre of her own work, which spans multiple scales and mediums, and has the most incredible relationship between different types of opacities, luminosities, materialities, translucency, colours, resonances. And I'm looking forward to a nice journey through a lot of that work and her ideas. So please welcome Joanna Gravunda.
So, first of all, thank you. I'm going to show two different types of work. So I work in a field that's now called art design, which is, I call it more theoretical design. What it is a kind of a new field where people do limited edition furniture or lighting or objects. This kind of work is shown in galleries, and it's sold to collectors or museums. And for me, this is my research arm of my practice because there's no actual client. So you don't have the whims of another person. You can be very pure. They usually only make 4 to 6 examples of each piece. So I only have to find 4 to 6 people in the entire world that even like what I do. So that gives me a lot of creative freedom. And I consider this part of my practice kind of like speed dating for research, because you can do a lot of iterations very quickly. You get feedback very quickly. You get results very quickly, and it's much more instant gratification than, say, the very long and torturous trajectory, which is architecture, which you will know soon. So that's one part of my work. The other part of my work is larger scale installation work and architectural interventions, collaborating with architects and artists as well. So Fiona said color is light. And I'm not a light designer, and I don't consider myself a light artist as well. I trained as an architect, and I worked many years with Sozzas in Milan as an architect, but now I find myself kind of in this blurry borders between architecture, art, and design. So just some quick background as far as color formation goes. I worked with Sotsas for 16 years, and Sotsas is obviously a sage about color. He's actually written books on color, so I won't go into it too much, except to say that he used color in a way to particularly distinguish different volumes of his work, and he had very dynamic architecture that we worked on together. This is the house in Colorado. One of the ways that stuck with me the most, and I've brought in through my own practice, is he talked about color in a way that I found very interesting, and I don't know if it's counterintuitive for today's symposium, but he's always said there is no such thing as color. There's only colored material. So if a client, it's the best example, if a client would come in, and they often did, and said things like, I don't like green, you know, he would say, what do you mean you don't like green? You don't like grass, or you don't like emeralds, or you don't like the Mediterranean. He was always saying, you can't just say, I don't like a color, or I like a color, or what's your favorite color? It's what's your favorite colored material. So he did work with paint. It's not that everything had to be a natural color, but it was always kind of a very bold use of it. And you can see by the green light on the right that at a certain point I started getting in my own little shouts here and there. So if me coming from Southern California in a mid-century modern home that I was raised in ever had any hopes of becoming a white form modernist, this completely helped me lose hope. So about halfway through my stay at Sotsas, I started trying to find my own voice. And the way to do that in Milan in the, say, early 90s was to do exhibitions. So people still do that. So I started designing things, furniture and light, and trying to kind of understand what was interesting to me, what could be different about what I was doing. So two things happened. Number one, with my work at Sotsas, I would be specifying colors in a Pantone specifier book. Do those even still exist? Okay. And it always felt to me like an entire section was missing. I would go through and it's like something, I could never really find what I wanted. At the same time, I was spending a lot of time fully immersed into the new digital computer world. So watching video games and playing with these colors and reading William Gibson's cyberpunk novels. So there to me was this whole new aesthetic, a new contemporary landscape that was out there that I wasn't seeing in flat color books. So I started integrating light into things because those were the colors that I was actually looking for, this luminosity that comes when you put light with color. So this was the first collection I did. You'll see titles here. The collections were usually kind of thematic, and sometimes the titles were just for my own diversion. Sometimes they had something to do with the concept. This was one of the first collections I did called Air Conditioning, and it was a kind of a reaction to the reaction that had happened with Memphis, where the reaction after was Milan went beige and chrome again. So I thought it was time to bring color back a little bit. Then I did a collection called Lighting Management, which is a little bit of a tongue-in-cheek against German lighting design, because at the time we were working with a German light company, and they were very much about how do you measure lumens in a room and how much light is getting in that corner. And there was no, I didn't feel like there was much emotionality to the way that they were doing it, so I took the title for these pieces, which were meant to be architectural installations. So as an architect, I wanted to see if I could do pieces that were actually integrated into architecture. So the idea here was you would buy this panel if you were too afraid to paint your wall or use a colored material. You would buy one of these panels, it would be the size of your room, and that would give you color and light as well. And I tried to use a lot of building materials, so acoustic foam or fiberglass, in order to get across this idea of an architectural intervention. I also started working a lot with mirror, mainly because you can get twice as much light if you put a mirror next to it, but as well you get a lot of interesting aesthetic effects that play with the architecture. And then in the same collection, there was a modular wall. So you wouldn't have to order it. You could order a certain number of panels, and you could fill up your wall and get it to be an architectural intervention. The next collection right after that when I realized that not everybody was dying to have a fluorescent orange wall in their house. I thought, well, let's go one more step. So these were called fractals because they're abstract forms and they're kind of scaleless. This could be enormous or it could be a tiny little jewel. It's actually about 6 feet wide. These are just made in aluminum and you would put them on your wall and you would paint them whatever color your wall happened to be. And then they would be like a prosthesis of the wall. So in the daytime, your wall was kind of this three-dimensional thing. And then when you turned it on, you'd have this sort of light effect that looked kind of like an integrated architectural element, let's say, like a light cove, but more. And then you could also put, if you were braver, you could put some colored light on that. So I got a commission to do, by the way, this project is the reason I'm here, because Antoni had seen it. I got a commission to do the lighting for the interior courtyard of the Museum of Contemporary Art in Siracusa in Sicily. And that was great, but they had zero money to do it. So I always quote Marcel Duchamp, who said, poor tools require better skills. In this case, I think poor budgets require more conceptual thinking, because you really have to invent it to get there. So I thought, well, what if we just painted these ancient Roman walls in fluorescent paint? And amazingly, they let me do it. And then hit them with blacklight. What would happen? And in fact, no one more surprised than me, by the way. It works. And they looked like projections. So you're getting the molecules of the fluorescent paint. When they get hit with black light, they get very excited and they actually illuminate in a crazy way. And you don't even have to shoot that much light up, but it'll catch the fluorescent paint. So this was one of the first major installation pieces that I did. Then I later did it with an artist named Ana Teresa Fernandez. She's a San Francisco artist, and we did this on a building in San Francisco that's it's currently up. Why? This is actually in the Tenderloin. I don't know if you know San Francisco. The Tenderloin's a kind of a rough area where people are staggering out of the bars half the time with syringes hanging out of their arm, and the idea was they would come out and just kind of like, why? Look up at it. So I also did some collections of objects. And I was asked to do a collection of ceramics, which is really hard, especially, Sotsas, for one, was also a master in ceramics. But the history of human civilization can be traced through shards of pottery. So it's actually quite a big order to do ceramics. So what I thought, to sort of avoid the formal aspect of it, was think, well, in the, you know, what will be a way that future generations, after the apocalypse, which hopefully doesn't come in the next 4 years, if it's going to come, it's going to come in the next 4 years, though. If, you know, what would be something you could do to a ceramic where years from now, a scientist or an anthropologist would find a shard and know that it was from the 21st century? Fluorescent paint. So these were actually painted with fluorescent paint. Just acrylic fluorescent paint. No baking or anything in there. So painting kind of became a way to get larger volumes without having to have too much materiality. This was a collection I did, my part of it, and then I worked with the conceptual artist Rob Pruitt, who did his own series of amazing pieces kind of in dialogue with it. But my idea, you know, Davos Dilemma, I don't know if you know this, it was this kind of interesting situation that came out in, this was 2008, out of the Davos Forum, which normally economic instability or global instability kind of wreaks economic instability. So if the world is stable, then the economy is stable. But what they started seeing happened was global instability was bringing global stimulation. So the example is, as the sale of military jets went up, so did the sale of private jets. And this was something that had never been seen before in the history of the world, because there should be some kind of correlation. In fact, there wasn't. So we used that. We loved that concept, and we loved commenting on it. So we just used that as a title, basically, in order to talk about art and architecture and art and the global economy and art and design. And my part of it was, let me see how big of volumes I can get with very thin material and using a lot of different coloring. So these are very thin material pieces with industrial materials, but making bigger volumes that I can use to refract the light. So these are two hanging lights, tritanopia and protanopia. These are two different types of color blindness. One is color blindness for red and yellow, and the other is for blues and greens. So I thought that would be an interesting title for them, names. And this was a project I did at Robert Restaurant at the Museum of Art and Design in New York. Amazingly, this photo is also looking onto Trump Hotel, that black building there. This is the view from the restaurant. And this is the view inside. So they hired me to do the lighting. The idea was to do lighting, light ceilings. And I wanted to give this very kind of dynamic movement with the light and the color, pink light, because everyone looks very healthy and happy if you're in pink light. And then also this kind of glowing orange on the corridor. Two different situations because the architecture has this very odd sort of corridor that goes around it. It's a building designed by Allied Architects Brad Klopfeld. And that's all fine and good, but I realized quite quickly that when you put pink light on food, you look very healthy, but if you happen to order spinach or salad, it looks brown. So we had to mitigate it with some strategically placed hidden MR16s. They're in there. And this is the view from Central Park. It's kind of the signage on the building. You can actually see this from Harlem as well, if you're interested. Just kind of showing the geometry through the color. So I work a lot with transparency and color. And for me, this idea of transparency and color and light, these are kind of like the materials or the qualities of the contemporary landscape. And it's a very interesting thing because they don't really have a weight or a cost. They're just sort of these strange kind of ineffable qualities. So when I worked with Glass Italia to work on mirrors, and not having the opportunity to do light, the idea then was just to layer colors and get these kind of interesting effects just by layering the color of glass one on top of the other and then holding it all together with a piece of mirror in the middle. This is a project for the Singapore Freeport. And a Freeport, I don't know if you know what it is, it's an enormous luxury storage situation. Where people go and they store their solid gold Rolls Royces or their collection of Fabergé eggs or whatever. And the client wanted to make it where people going there to visit their stuff could also have a nice experience. So I did all the lighting on the outside and the inside. And the facade is a plant wall. You see it here kind of starting to grow in. So my idea was to put panels which are backlit in green as the plants grow in, so that the plants actually look like they're bioluminescent, so they're kind of glowing in the evening. And in fact, the original panels were supposed to be solar panels, so they would just be almost passive. They'd be collecting the light during the day, and then at night they would emanate this green LED out the back. The problem is in Singapore, you're basically on the equator, so there's no sun ever hits vertical, so we ended up putting a bank of solar panels on the roof, and they're remotely powered, but it's still good. Then on the inside, there's a series of light ceilings and light installations that are kind of working directly with the geometry of the architecture. So on the left side and the right side, you see this is the big lobby. That big piece in the middle kind of moving up like that is an enormous Ron Arad sculpture, which was at the Museum of Modern Art and now is permanently here in the Singapore Freeport. So by day, these are kind of mirrored walls just hanging, mimicking a little bit the architectural pattern of windows done by the architect, Carmelo Stendardo. He's a Swiss architect. And then by night, we can control them to be any color that we want. This was a collection I did for Carpenter's Workshop Gallery for their gallery in Paris, Big Sky. You've seen some of my work already tonight. They said something to me that no one had ever said to me before, which was, we like your minimal work. And I really had to work at that because I never thought of myself as a minimalist. But they wanted the minimal stuff. So what I thought to do would be to see if I could do a collection where it was one thing when it was off and it was another thing when it was on. And this is one light. I worked with a very brilliant engineer, Paolo Salvagioni, on the electronics of this. So when it's off, it's just a hanging thin aluminum sheet. And when it's on, the inside is a blue light, and then it makes a white light outside. And this is all done with filters in a very strong spotlight situation. So this is a coffee table. When it's off, it's just a big black slab. And when it's on, there's just like a little slight tease of, you know, maybe that's bad manufacturing, but it's not. You know, just a little bit of green kryptonite coming out of the edge. And then this are just aluminum panels by day. And then when you light them up, they're different colors, color-changing LEDs. So this light was called Slab, and it's very large, and it's very thin. And if you know anything about lighting, you'll understand that this is really hard to do. You can do small and very thin, or you can do big and very thick. But to do very big and very thin is super, super difficult. It takes a lot of engineering. So again, I worked with a couple engineers on this. And what we wanted to get was a beautiful white, even light, and then shoot a little blue out the back of it, just to kind of give it more definition. But when it's off, it's a mirror, and then it has this light. So you get this kind of interesting effect, the on and the off. Now, you saw how this was installed. During the exhibition, a lot of people said, this would be really great over a bed. And it took me a while. I didn't really get that. And then I was like, finally, oh yeah, okay, the mirror over the bed thing. So I thought, well, that's interesting. So I started thinking about pornography and how the pornography industry is actually known for taking new technology and using them more intelligently and in a newer way than other industries. So I thought, well, maybe there's some tips there for me in lighting. So I Googled light porn, and I got 30 million hits. And because then I realized I was Googling light porn. Yeah. So I went down that rabbit hole for a while, and when I came back out, I did have one good quote, which was an ex-porn star named Gloria Leonard, and she said, the difference between pornography and erotica is lighting. And I just thought that was just so beautiful. Fantastic. So this is light porn on a large scale. This is the Luxembourg Freeport. It's another Freeport, an enormous building. I thought, because it's this huge building and they wanted the lighting done, I thought, what if we just do some really big, like, tags, light tags? So I put a bunch of these light tags through it. And then in the daytime, they're mirrors and they bring the more natural light in. And then at night, they shoot stripes all over the place. We did one green fluorescent tube that went all the way up the elevator. So you get this whole thing that at night becomes almost like an aquarium with greens and blue light, and then these light tags, which really are illuminating this entire huge space. That strange image you see on the over there on the right is a sculpture. It's 30 meters long by a Portuguese artist named Vils, V-H-I-L-S. He's a street artist, and where JR does, posters and things, and a lot of artists do painting, Vils actually works with a jackhammer. So he goes to walls and he jackhammers out his graffiti. And this is one of his pieces that was commissioned for the building. So here you see part of his wall reflected in the mirror, and then when the light is on, and then when the light is on with the blue. This I put in here because it's just, it was a loft I did a while ago, and there's three different layers of pink. So this is actually, they're actually painted three different colors. What struck me is when I got the photographs back, they insisted as well on doing black and white photographs. So I thought that was a kind of an interesting thing. Like that way they had an option whether to really show that these were three pink walls or to show that maybe they were just shades of gray or something. There's a lot of chromophobia in the world, by the way. So I started working, or you know, I started working with this color-changing LED. It's called RGB, and I was very resistant at first because it's very gadgety. You know, you see it in, you see it all over the place with all the colored lights and the flashing and all that. And I really didn't know how to handle that kind of light. So it took me a while to kind of embrace this. And I started working with how can I use it to mix colors on different surfaces and create pieces by doing that with this colored light. But mostly what I understood at a certain point was people, when they see that light, they're actually delighted. And I was trying to figure out why are they delighted? And I think it's because there's a certain quality, it seems magic, because these are colors that you do not see in nature. So there's probably a part of us that's seeing these colors, and it's something is registering that's a unique thing. It's a unique experience in this moment to be seeing all these luminous colors together that you don't really see in nature. So this was the wall together, on or off with mirror, and then on becoming lights. So this was a collection I did here in London for Carpenter's Gallery, called No Whining on the Yacht. And there was a lot of reasons for that. The main reason was the gallery is on Albemarle Street, or how do you say it? Or Albemarle in Mayfair. And it's a super chic, super exclusive part of town. And I just thought, well, you know, anyone walking off the street buying one of these pieces is going to be a very wealthy person. So, you know, why don't we just do just a little tweak? So this was stenciled on the window of the gallery. And when I got there for the opening, I actually, and this is true, the coincidence, the store right in front of the gallery across the street is actually a yacht showroom. So it was a kind of a fortuitous coincidence there. So I did four pieces, and they were each based on what would be the perfect color for this thing. So this is a floor light. It's quite tall. And it's called Pink Void, because pink makes the nice pink light. What would be the perfect color for a little coffee table? This is just a very simple coffee table. It's actually a little slanted, so you can put a glass of wine down, but the table's, you know, not quite. The wine looks kind of strange, and it has a little bit of green street glow on it. This is called Black Dot. What's the perfect color for a dining room table? This is called Red Devil. And the way we got this sort of Rothko-ish effect in the middle is that the red part is actually illuminated. So I didn't want it to look like a light table. I just wanted it to give a red color that was something that you've never really seen. So it wasn't, you know, you couldn't quite tell, is this some amazing, you know, Japanese lacquer that's so luminous, I'm getting this effect, or is it, you know, a reflection from the light that's hitting it? Well, in fact, it was just a super, super, super low level of LED light on that side of the table, and then the rest of the table just has the same glass, so it gives a black effect, and you get this interesting effect in the middle. So I don't know if that means, like, you know, boys sit on the right side, girls sit on the left, or I'm not sure how that works. And then what's the perfect color for a chandelier? Well, that is, of course, gold, so this is the gold bar. And in this case, it's gold, painted gold on the inside. It's kind of a brownish bronze on the outside. But the LED light itself is shooting through a gold filter, so you're getting a very gold refracted light. I just wanted to use light strips of LED. The problem with that is you see the dots, and everybody hates to see the dots. So we tried filters, and they were just kind of dull. And then I put perforated metal, very tiny dot perforated metal in front of it. And what happened was it lit up like diamonds, basically. So you get this very brilliant diamondy effect, because at that point you're refracting the light. You're not filtering it, really. You're not trying to put it down. You're trying to kind of exemplify it. So you're breaking up one dot into many dots. So hashtag Fendi Miami, you'll see why I put that. Fendi had seen, the fashion house Fendi had seen my Syracuse walls, and they asked me to do some tags on this building. This is an Art Deco building in the design district of Miami. And I thought, well, I've already done that, so that's not so fun, but what about doing some more fully immersive part of the architecture? So we did the upper balcony and the portico. This is the upper balcony, and it's done in fluorescent green and shot with black light as well. So when they have parties, you know, people are out there with the green light on their faces, the white, you know, white shirt that becomes phosphorus and all that. And the corridor is what did you call it? Immersive pop? This is the maximum immersive pop. Right. And it really is like this. And so what I discovered on Instagram was, in fact, hashtag Fendi Miami. People go there, and local people actually go to this portico to take selfies. And there's hundreds of posts on it, which I love. So I got a job to do a collector who wanted me to do their flat in Monte Carlo. And the colors of Monte Carlo, because Monte Carlo is very yachty, the colors are white and bluette, basically, white and bluette. And they asked me to do something that was very non-Monte Carlo. So I did my best. There's lots of luminous stuff and lots of gray walls. And we tried to really break the aesthetic of the Monte Carlo yachtiness. So, of course, a house like that would have to have a color-changing wall depending on your mood. But, and Nicholas, this one's for you. But in my trips to Monte Carlo, I got another job, and that was in, it was a commission for a house that Tom Dixon designed for a client in Monte Carlo as an homage to Corbusier, because Corbusier, of course, has a big presence in that area, and he's buried in Roquebrune, which is the little town on the hill above Monte Carlo. So for me, it was just a chance to re-emert after many, many years to Corbusier and read your book, Nicholas, which was fascinating, and just, you know, let it brush over me in order to get some inspiration for this project. And what caught me most, the most apt thing, was Corbusier's light cannons. So this is La Tourette. Corbusier did these protrusions out of the roof of La Tourette, and they're painted in, the top is a skylight, but they don't read as skylights. They read as these cannons that bring light in. For me, I just thought that was an amazing, inspirational idea, concept. So this is my light cannon. It's a little bit more literal. It has a very strong spotlight as well as some color, that, you know, blue color in it, so it can be blue or white, and there's blue outside. And this is it in Tom Dixon's house there, the light cannon, which does give a big, strong light down there while making the rest of the place all kind of bluish. This is the last project I'll show. It's Magic Cloud. This is a private commission for a house that Peter Marino did in San Francisco. And this is a vault over a stair. It's from an existing house, and he doesn't leave anything simple. So the walls themselves are actually completely painted by an artist, and then I did my installation in there. So this is what we got, this idea of having these kind of mirrored, magic mirror butterflies, or bats if you want, that are kind of clinging to the form of the vault, and then they each are controlled separately with colored light and white light. So we can do a series of narratives. And I worked with a theater designer who actually helped me program narratives. So this can be, you know, a sunset where it actually changes colors of a sunset in real time with what's going on outside. So you'll see this kind of wash of pink, or it can be this kind of blue and white aquarium sort of look, or it can be this kind of, you know, festival of lights. It's actually an unlimited series of narratives you can do. And it's interesting to design a piece, but then also have to design how people will experience this. So, you know, you're used to turning on and off a button and maybe you get to dim it. But now you don't, not only can you change the color of it, but you can also create your own experience in it. So it can go with the music if you're having a party. It can be all green on St. Patrick's Day, or however way you want to do it. And in this case, for me, this piece is 100% just defined by the color. So color changes everything, in fact. Thank you.